Welcome to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast, where it's all about real women, real stories, real inspiration. And now your host and creator of Moms Making Six Figures, Heidi Bartolotta.
Hi, today we're here with Jennifer Becker. And Jen's background is in supply chain. She's a mom of two amazing daughters. And I thought I would start out today by asking you to talk a little bit about how you ended up in supply chain, very male-dominant industry, especially in aerospace where you started out. So talk about that path. There's a lot of women that will be watching that are younger in their career path, maybe younger in their entrepreneurial journey. And I know that you learned a lot in those, especially in those early years. So will you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it was kind of by chance. I was going to school to be a teacher because I always envisioned at some point being a mom. And I thought, gosh, wouldn't that be cool to have summers off? And as, you know, came about, time to do your student teaching, realizing, oh my goodness, you don't get paid for that. And I had a full-time job. And then realizing I was likely going to make less as a teacher as this career that I kind of just ended up by chance in aerospace. I was working as a buyer's assistant. And so it really made me reevaluate. I knew I wanted financial security from a young age. My parents had me young, they were 20, they had my brother by the time they were 22. And I watched them at different points of their lives struggle financially. And I mean, they were amazing parents and we wanted for nothing, but I knew I wanted financial security. And so it really forced me to reevaluate, what am I going to school for? So I made a shift to business management and I just kind of went after it. A buyer was going out on maternity leave and I took a leap of faith and I went to my boss and I said, I want that job. And he said, you have to have a degree. And I said, I'm working for one and I know I can do it. You know, I've seen their purchase orders. I help with contract negotiations. And, you know, even though I'm the assistant, I know I am so capable of this job. And he gave it to me. And it was the first time in life I went, oh my goodness, if you ask for it, you can possibly get it.
I was going to say you were super bold.
Yeah. And my parents had such an amazing work ethic. So they always really set that example for me. I remember, vividly remember a time I must have been, I don't know, as young as six. And we had family plans for the weekend and my dad came home and he said, I have to work. And, you know, he told my mom, you know, my boss said, if I take these, you know, extra odds and ends jobs, I could be a supervisor. Do you know what that would mean for our family? Mm-hmm. And in that moment, I think my mom could have went two directions. She could have been the annoyed wife or supportive. And I watched her support him and encourage him and said, yeah, you got to do it. And just watching my dad work his way up the corporate ladder, and then as we got older, watching my mom, I'd always watch them really go after what they wanted. And, you know, maybe they made small sacrifices here and there, but in the long run, maybe we missed a Saturday as a family day. But long term, you know, he did become that supervisor and that manager and that VP, which afforded things that kids needed, like braces and extracurriculars. And so those are really, I guess, solid example for me growing up.
Okay, so talk a little bit about, though, because I know being a female in that industry, and I know the kind of work ethic that you had to exude in order to not only fill that role, but then eventually actually be given that role and then to continue to advance. So talk a little bit about that, because I know it wasn't easy, so you can soften it, but I want the honesty. Like, what was that like? And especially with so many men around you, and not only were you female, you were young.
Yeah, it was a tough industry to step into. People were definitely well established in their careers. At the time I was working for a company, there were only 10 people under the age of 30. So me coming in, I was already referred to as the kid. I was a third generation employee. My grandfather retired from there. My parents worked there. So, you know, yes, I kind of had an in, but not in that industry. My parents worked in different areas of the company. And so I really had to push. It was a lot of doing the tasks no one wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I remember there was this program manager and everybody said, you know, oh, he's a jerk. He's crazy. He's insane. And he wanted someone to fly to Wisconsin in the middle of February and sit there until that order was done. And no one wanted to go. Everyone had kids and it was cold. And I said, I'll do it. And, you know, here I was, 22 years old. Most of my friends are out partying on the weekend. And I had to go sit in the middle of nowhere, Wisconsin, for 2.5 weeks waiting for this part to be done. But that was really when I started to make a name for myself. He had no idea who I was up until that point. And then I kind of became known as the girl who would go get things done. You know, if you needed someone to go push on a supplier, send Jen. She'll go do it. She'll sit there. She'll ask the hard questions of the suppliers. And so that was actually when I got promoted the first time. They promoted me to a senior buyer. And it was a big deal. It was, mm-hmm. you know, people wanted to know how one female, two young. And I just knew it was all those little things no one wants to do. It was doing the grunt work. I remember my dad telling me, it doesn't matter, you know, from the janitor to the president of the company, if you're asked to do something, don't ever say, it's not my job or it's not my responsibility. And you respect everyone, you know, if mm-hmm. there's trash in the hallway, pick it up. Or if somebody needs, you know, copies made, you go do it. And so I kind of became the yes girl in my career, but it's what helped me make a name. People knew I would get it done.
I was going to say, so tell me about when you hit six figures, because I know that you know exactly the moment.
Yep.
And I want to hear about it. I want to hear just everything emotionally that happened for you in that moment, because you were young.
Yeah, it was a very kind of trying time in life. I was newly married. I thought we would have children right away. Didn't turn out that way. And the company had a massive layoff. Working in 9/11 or working in aerospace after 9/11 was a really tough place to be. It was a very volatile industry. And they were walking people out left and right. And I remember calling my husband in the parking lot at lunch saying, I think I'm going to lose my job today. He said, you're kidding. And we had, you know, just bought a bigger house. And so it was a stressful time, you know, and we were going through fertility at the time for fertility treatments, and those were costly. And he's just like, Jen, this just isn't the time to lose a job. And I said,
like, I know,
I know, I know. And I just watched person after person, you know, get walked out. And finally the president of the company called me in and I thought, here it is, like, here's my layoff. And he said, you've really proven yourself. I had switched companies at this point. So now I was kind of on my own. I didn't have my grandfather's name or my parents' name anymore to kind of rest on. And I really made a name for myself at this company all on my own. And he said, you've really proven yourself. And we are giving you the title of supply chain manager. And I remember in that moment, my heart just kind of sinking because I really went in prepared to be laid off. Mm-hmm. And I remember the exact offer letter. I remember the exact amount. I remember like calling my husband going, oh my goodness, guess what? I didn't get laid off. And he said, oh, good. And I said, it's better. You're now talking to the supply chain manager. And he was just floored. I mean, he couldn't believe it. And he said, of course, you know, do you make more money? And I said, I do, and I'm going to make six figures. And he was just like, are you kidding? And it was $102,900. And I was 25 years old. And I just thought, all of that work and all of those, you know, trips, staying in hotel rooms in the middle of nowhere, you know, there only being, you know, fast food options around and driving in the snow. And, you know, I remember the first time going to one of these suppliers and asking, what is this? And them saying, it's a snow scraper. And I, you know, it was from California. I never dealt with that. And it just kind of in that moment, it made me realize all of those trips, all of those late nights, early mornings, like it was totally worth it. Where a lot of people my age, that's not what they were doing. I mean, the weekend came, it was going out time. And yeah, I had my fun too, but, you know, during the week, it was all about work for me. You know, Friday and Saturday, yeah, maybe I'd go out, but, you know, I was one of those that I worked, and I worked really hard. But the reward is where we are now. Mm-hmm. Like, financially, you know, finances isn't what keeps me up at night.
Right.
You know, it's not a concern for us. And, you know, we're not wealthy by any means, but I would say we are well taken care of.
So talk a little bit about that, because I think you brought up some really important things that we have an audience that a good portion of them are aspiring to six figures, right? And whether that's in a career or whether that's in an entrepreneurial venture, one of the things that you said that I think I would like you to just talk a little bit more about is you did the work. Like, you took on the things that other people didn't want to do. And there's a quote that I love, and I love quotes, but you can always work harder. You can always work harder than the other person, right? And I think about that a lot when I, for example, see people complaining about the fact that they're not where they want to be. And I always think, well, what's that additional 1% that you can do, right? So talk about that and how you dealt with it mentally, because it seemed like just what you did.
Mm-hmm. It's funny. I had reconnected with one of my old bosses, and it was, you know, happened to be one of the bosses where I, you know, asked for more responsibility. And what he said to me was, I remember you sitting there, you know, this young girl in her 20s, and, you know, he had even admitted he hadn't had many female employees in his career. And he said, you sat there and said, I will outwork anyone. Mm-hmm. And he said, I just didn't think you knew what that meant. And he said, you absolutely knew what that meant. I mean, I was one of the first people there in the morning and one of the last people there at night. But I knew that wasn't a forever thing.
Right.
And what I watch is people want six figures or they want financial security, but they're not willing to make the sacrifice long enough. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, I'm going to work this hard for a couple months. When in reality, it was a good year of working at that pace. But now when I look back, it was such a blip on the radar. It was before kids. You know, my husband was also climbing the corporate ladder, so we both worked a ton. I mean, I remember our neighbors. We, you know, bought this house. We you know, kind of knew eventually we'd have kids in. And they said, you know, until you had kids, we didn't know who lived there. Because, you know, we'd leave when it was dark. We'd come home when it was dark. And then because we worked so hard, when weekends came, we would, you know, take some out-of-town trips. That was how we would decompress. And I would say that's something important, too. You know, yes, you can make a lot of sacrifices and work really hard. But, you know, there's something to be said for work hard, play hard. I mean, we did a lot of mm-hmm. fun weekend trips where we would put away our phones. Or back then it was Blackberries. And, you know, we both knew working hard early was going to provide a lot more for us later and when kids came.
I would say that you definitely know how to reward yourself. But that, knowing you, I know
we
that.
We had a lot of fun. Yeah.
So you are an entrepreneur now. You own your own business, and you were in the corporate environment very successfully for a long time. We talk about that shift going from, you know, working for someone to working for yourself. What was that like for you?
Yeah, it was definitely a challenge at first. I was used to being in an office so many hours a week. I was used to, you know, this is the contract that needs to be negotiated. Here's the cost savings we need. And when you go to working for yourself, there's no one telling you what time your workday starts. There's no meeting notices coming through on Outlook deciding your day. And it was difficult because there was this part of me that was like, oh, now the kids are in, you know, part-time school. Let's go to the park. Let's go to the zoo. And then, you know, there's this part of you, oh my gosh, the work is still there. It's not getting done. So it was definitely a shift of deciding, okay, how many hours a week am I truly going to put into building something of my own? And being very calendar aware. Mm-hmm. It's probably not a term a lot of people hear, but being aware of what's on your calendar. I think there's also this shift where people look at, you know, oh, Jen quit her corporate job. You know, she can go to lunch and we can go here and we can go there. Or, you know, you can become the person to go run errands. And, you know, you kind of have to be really clear with your family too. I still very much work, you know, being a business owner. Now it's just me. So if I'm not working, there's no income coming in. So it was the shift of, you know, I'm an early riser, which I think, you know, suits me, not everyone. Some people I think do better working late at night. But for me, I kind of like, you know, put the kids in bed, have a little bit of downtime reading or something to quiet my mind. It's always going. But then still starting my day every day, you know, I still get up and get ready every day, which is kind of funny to some people. But I feel like, you know, that was kind of what I did in the corporate world. And I just feel better when I put a little makeup on and gotten ready for the day. And
don't you think it's just habit? It creates a, like a winning habit for
you. Yeah, it's definitely a habit. Yeah. It's a habit of, okay, it's, you know, time to work. And obviously now that my children are in school, that's an easier age because, you know, there's the school drop off and then maybe a workout. And then, you know, it's my work day. And I definitely schedule a few fun lunches in with, you know, girlfriends here and there throughout the week, which is something fun that maybe I couldn't have done in the corporate world. But for the most part, I've created, you know, my ideal work day and just having that freedom. And, you know, if we do want to go visit my parents out of state and take off on a Thursday because it's, you know, less than flying on the weekend, we have that flexibility, which is really nice.
Would you suggest it to others?
Yeah, I think definitely find something that's going to suit you well. Again, what are you passionate about? You know, I love helping other women, you know, in the space that I'm in now. I'm super passionate about helping people achieve what I've achieved. And gosh, if I can help people with lessons learned and, you know, avoid some of the mistakes I made early on, I love being able to do that. I love helping others kind of achieve that six-figure lifestyle, I guess you could call it, and also having time freedom. But find something you can be passionate about. Find something that will allow you to capitalize on the skills you've already gained. You know, what did you learn in your corporate career? What can you do on your own that you know you can be successful at? And again, finding something you're passionate about, it doesn't feel so much like work.
And I think it goes back to what you said early on, which is just learning from the mistakes, you know, the failures, the whatever you want to call them. But that tends to be the time that we really learn. So
find someone that has what you want and don't be scared to ask some questions about it. I mean, I have some really great mentors in my life and I remember asking them early on some tough questions and just, you know, little things I was curious about. And you'd be surprised how many people are willing to be open and share with you. And yeah, find some great mentors or find people who have the success that you are looking to achieve and pick their brain a little bit.
It's such an interesting thing. That has been a theme, I think, in every woman that I've interviewed in some way has said, basically, like, ask for help. Ask for guidance, ask for wisdom from someone else. And I think especially younger women sometimes feel insecure about doing that. And it's such a powerful piece of learning, right? So,
And there's something to be said for even seeking out, you know, if you're a female, asking another female, because let's be honest, there's things in the workplace men aren't dealing with. I mean, love my husband, but he wasn't the one taking the kids to doctor's appointments or registering them in school or doing all of the extra mom tasks. Doesn't mean that he's not a great dad, but there's just things that we as women take on and you have these extra responsibilities. And I remember early on asking, you know, another successful woman, like, how do you balance it? Like, I want to go on that field trip, but I also have this really big, you know, income goal that I want to hit this year. And, you know, how do you balance it? Or, you know, do I join the PTA or do I not? Because I know that's more time out of my day, but, you know, it's finding the right things to be present in.
Yeah. Thank you for that. So you had a very substantial income in the corporate environment. You were probably about as high as you can go in supply chain. And yet you chose to transition into business ownership. What prompted that for you? What was the driver behind that?
It's one of those things that just doesn't leave you. My oldest daughter, they were doing like a Mother's Day thing where they had grown some of their own stuff, I guess, you know, for a Mother's Day salad lunch. And you know, she said, remember when all the mommies came and you didn't? And it just, your heart kind of sinks. And it was realizing in that moment, as much as I loved my career, supply chain, a lot of things were going overseas, a lot of manufacturing was changing, and, you know, my job always included travel, and that just wasn't going to go away in that industry. And I even remember switching jobs and, you know, the boss saying, oh yeah, this will be better. You won't travel as much. And within 2 weeks I was on a plane to Ireland, and I went, oh, so much for the not as much travel. And I just remember looking at her thinking, this is what it's going to be like. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be a lot more times that I have to tell her no, or I can't be there. And it's funny because I didn't really envision, you know, ever being a stay-at-home mom. You know, I don't know, weird to say, judge me, not judge me, but I like to work. I like working. I like being busy. And that was when I thought, okay, what talents do I possess? What value can I add outside of corporate? And can I work for myself? Mm-hmm. And it was talking to other women that had started businesses outside of corporate and realizing, if I wanted the freedom to go on a field trip or a class party or be more present for my children, based on the career I had to make a shift. And that's not for every woman. I mean, there are a lot of flexible career options, but it just wasn't one mm-hmm. that I was in. And I remember early on, you know, one of my male bosses telling me it gets harder as you keep climbing the ladder, and him just thinking, oh, he just doesn't want to see me be successful. But I think he knew what was coming, you know, after my first daughter was born. And so it did. My kids really pushed me to look at other ways to create income. And I mean, they're a huge part of my why, and being present for them, it's amazing. And it's amazing that, you know, there are options. You can work hard and be present. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say you can have it all, but I feel like you can if you find the right vehicle to do that.
Yeah, I agree. So speaking to our audience, some business wisdom, you know, what are one or two things that you would tell a woman 10 years, maybe 15 years younger than you, that's really looking at coming up in their career or really taking their entrepreneurial venture and really making it the success that they want it to be? What are those couple of things that you might tell someone?
Personal and professional development is huge for me. Mm-hmm. I'm someone that, you know, when there were different classes that were offered, I would take them. I took, you know, I want to say all the touchy-feely classes as well, how to communicate, you know, Franklin Covey, time management. When those types of things were offered, I knew that those would serve me well. I pride myself on time management. I always say I can get probably more done in a short amount of hours than most people because, you know, I did educate myself on areas, and there's always areas for improvement. You know, becoming a good communicator, that was something I really had to learn as well, just how to communicate effectively. And I mean, there's literally courses for all of that, and I would recommend doing that, reading. I love, you know, personal development books. I love podcasts. And
okay, so I'm going to stop you there. So Give us a book. If you are, is there a book that when you're talking to someone and you're in kind of almost like that mentor role as someone that's maybe a little bit further along in their journey, is there a book that you say, oh, you need this one, this one?
One of the books that touched me, my husband is a huge sports fan, and so we often will relate, you know, professional experiences to sports analogies, and A Champion's Mind, it's really a lot about athletes and how, you know, they're just a step above the rest, and it's a lot about how to kind of retrain your mind so that you can really thrive. But I can always find a way to kind of relate that back to a professional experience. And, you know, it is similar, right? Like, you don't become a great athlete by practicing when you feel like it or when you're in the mood. I mean, they practice day in and day out, and that's kind of how it is in a career. You really have to dedicate yourself and decide, I'm going to give a good year of my life. I always think a year. I don't know why a year, just, you know, whether it's an exercise program or a diet or whatever. I think a year is a really good time to, okay, I'm going to dedicate this time. And then at that mark, you can evaluate, did I achieve what I set out to achieve?
It's significant. And also, I think a lot about that. It's funny that you say a year, but I think a lot of times when someone, you know, wants something different, and let's just say it's in a career or in a weight loss program or something like that, they evaluate too much. And that stops you along the way, right? Where if you just go head down for a year in anything, you're gonna really know the result at the end of that time. Or you will be able to evaluate, to your point, at the end of that time. Yeah,
it's when I wanted to go out on my own and work for myself, and, you know, I definitely tried some different things, you know, consulted in supply chain and different arenas of my life, but I told my husband, give me 1 year. I need 1 year with my head down, focused, and if I can replace my corporate income, you know, then we'll know I can do it. If I don't, then I don't, but I need a year. I need a year without question, a year without, you know, being too overly critical. Because it's so true, like 12 months, right? And you think about that when you look back, it's like, I remember that year, and I remember there being some stress and some tears and some late nights and being overly tired. But in the same token, it's like that year went by so fast. Mm-hmm. And it was like, you know, it was so worth it.
So we have an audience of probably mainly women that are listening to us right now. And a lot of them, as I said, are aspiring to six figures. Anything that I didn't ask you, anything that if one of them was sitting here with you, that you would say, here's what you need to know, sweetie.
That's a hard one. Be passionate about whatever it is you are doing. If you don't love it, you're likely not going to stick with it long term. I loved working in supply chain. From aerospace, I went to consumer packaged goods, and I was just fascinated in that career. Ingredients and, you know, just the way things are made, and working from, you know, with top skincare companies and cosmetic lines to working with food companies and working with small entrepreneurs trying to launch a brand. And those were things that I was really passionate about. So I loved that career and I loved the industry. So I would say, one, you have to be passionate about what you're doing. And two, get some buy-in from those around you, whoever your support team is, you know, whether it's a spouse or, you know, your parents or your best friend. I think you need that cheerleader along the way. And my husband was that for me, my parents, and now my girls, the ages they're at, they understand that mom works, but they also understand that, you know, we get to do things that, you know, maybe they wouldn't do if mom didn't work. I mean, they've been to Europe. And
so talk a little bit about that, because you are a mom, an amazing mom of two girls that are just exceptional. And talk about that balance, because there are a lot of women, I think, that really struggle with that. Like, how do I have a career and be successful, but also be a successful parent? Like, what is their balance?
There is. And I think it changes over time. And what I like to say is my life got completely out of balance before I could get it in balance, especially when you're pushing for a big goal. You know, when they're younger, yes, they spend some time in daycare. They went to preschool. And did I have a little bit of guilt about that? Sure, here and there. But at the same time, when I am with them, I'm super present with them. Mm-hmm. And I almost think for them, they thrived a little bit on that too. They're both very social. They're both very well-traveled. And, you know, they do well in social situations with adults. And I think it was because they had that mix of, you know, I'm not a stay-at-home mom, that's what I'll say, but I'm a work-from-home mom. And now that they've gotten older, we definitely set some boundaries. You know, they know in the summer that mom's going to work for the first couple hours of the day, and I need some uninterrupted work time. They are 9 and 11, so they get that. But then they know we're going to go do whatever it is they want to do. You know, sometimes it's the water park. Sometimes it's getting out on the river or whatever, you know, or they know we're going to get long weekends or they're going to get some fun trips, but they're pretty respectful of the boundaries, but we've set them as a family that, you know, these are the hours that mom's going to work. They can get some screen time out of it, you know, or read or whatever. And
don't you think it teaches them a really significant life skill?
I absolutely think it does. And they have to manage their time. You know, we will kind of set out a schedule and we'll say, here's what you can have on the screen time. And I want this much time of reading. And they're both really self-sufficient children. My husband always jokes and he says, we're raising adults, not children. And I remember when they were younger, that used to get to me. I'm like, let them be kids. But he said, you know, we are raising these humans that have to go out in the world and function without us at some point. And he said, we've all been there, right? Where you're in college and you see the kids who are thriving and you see the kids who are really struggling. And, you know, we want them to have the best experience when they do go out into life. And so now I totally see why, you know, he would reference that so much. And, you know, they're definitely kids, but they are very self-sufficient children. And, you know, they enjoy my work. You know, I've taken my 11-year-old on a business trip and she thought it was the greatest thing in the world and got to miss school and wrote an entire report about it for her teacher. But I think it's kind of cool that, you know, they see me working, but also that, you know, they see me as a very present mom as well.
Are you glad that you made the sacrifices early on?
I am. Like, if I could give that advice to anyone, I would say, you know, going back to your 20-year-old self, you know, don't buy the fancy car, put your money in the bank, work hard now, because, you know, we've created a lifestyle that, you know, if we want to go travel for 6 weeks in the summer, we can absolutely do that. And we've set ourselves up financially to have that freedom. Mm-hmm. And when you're not stressed about things like debt and bills and, you know, how you're going to pay that next mortgage payment, life is just, it's almost like you can breathe.
I was going to say, you have a very rich life.
And we have. We've definitely been down the road where, you know, we've overextended ourselves. And when the economy crashed in 2008, we made some poor investments. And, you know, we've definitely been there where, yeah, money troubles have kept us up at night. But again, we decided, like, okay, we're just going to work really hard so that we don't get back in this situation. And I would say learn from every mistake. You know, there's definitely times where in your career, it's like, maybe I should have taken that job or maybe I should have done this. And you almost have to look back and go, okay, what can I learn from this?
Yeah.
What can I do differently next time? Or what can I say next time that opportunity is offered to me?
Yeah. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, it was really nice to sit and chat with you. And I think you provided a lot of great wisdom for those that are going to watch this. So thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast. If you enjoyed this podcast, please take a moment and leave a review on iTunes. To learn more about Moms Making Six Figures, head over to momsmakingsixfigures.com. That's right, momsmakingsixfigures.com.